Hey folks, it's Jared Manninen from the website TahoeTrailGuide.com. Today I'm going to be talking about the types of clothing that I like to wear when cross-country skiing and snowshoeing, as well as the different criteria that I use in order to determine the clothing that I'm going to be wearing for the day's adventure. Right off the bat, I just want to put out a couple of disclaimers and disclosures. Basically, I buy all the gear that I have. I have the credit card debt to prove it. So I'm not sponsored, I'm not a brand ambassador, I don't get gear for free to review. I talk about gear because it is an inherent part of going outside and having an adventure, but I like to speak on terms that are broad and based in principles, not so much specific details of one brand's offering or another. If I'm not here to sell you the latest and greatest jacket or ski pants, what am I going to be talking about? I mentioned the idea of criteria that I use to determine what clothes I wear for the day. So let's talk about that. This is something that you can apply to your process of getting ready to go outside. Both cross-country skiing and snowshoeing are highly aerobic activities, so you're going to be sweating in the winter. A motto that I tend to use, and it's not super clever or anything, is just wear light and pack heavy. I'm not saying put a bunch of bricks in your backpack. What I'm saying is dress pretty casually, pretty light, because you're going to be sweating. And pack heavy, what I'm referring to is if you do plan on being out all day or taking long breaks, go ahead and pack a bulky puffy jacket or some extra layers of pants or something like that. So if you do end up getting cold while you're outside, you can throw these bigger, heavier layers on. I know they're not heavy, but just an easy way for me to remember. Wear light, pack heavy. But back to the criteria. So there's five criteria. I consider the temperature. I consider whether or not wind is going to be present, whether or not there's going to be precipitation involved, the terrain that I'm going to be going across or the route that I select. And then the last thing is, what's my purpose for the day? Of those five criteria, what would you consider to be uncontrollable criteria, and what would you consider to be controlled criteria? Like, what do you have control over of those five items? It's a trick question though, and I'll come back to it after I talk about each one individually. So that first criteria is temperature. What's the outside air temperature? That's pretty standard for most people when they're about to go do something outdoors and it's the winter, really, right? Because I'm in the US, we use Fahrenheit. So when I refer to numbers, just know that it's in Fahrenheit. But generally speaking, here in Sierra Nevada, where I live, it is often just somewhere between 25 and 35 degrees on any given winter day. There's always exceptions, stuff that goes down into the single digits and teens. And then there's always the spring-like condition days where it becomes 45 degrees and still technically winter. So it can be challenging to dress, not because it's so cold, but because there's usually a pretty significant range. We can easily go from 18 degrees in the morning to 45 degrees in the afternoon. Yeah, that's kind of an interesting thing to plan for, right? But I grew up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan and in the Twin Cities of Minnesota. My first 18 years, I split about half time in both of those locations. So I went from one location where I was surrounded by Lake Superior, and as a result, we ended up having a ton of lake effect snow, wet, heavy, humid type snow, and lots of it. And then to lower Minnesota near the Twin Cities, where we would get sub-zero days for a couple weeks in a row. So huge extremes. I've lived in snowy climates for the majority of my life, and that kind of has informed me a lot about what to wear when I'm out cross-country skiing and snowshoeing. So I've been around a range of different types of winter, and I will say that here in Tahoe, I like this the best. I don't mind it being in the 20s. It's a wonderful temperature to be out playing in the snow with. That said, generally my temperature ranges as far as when I start to make considerably different gear choices or clothing choices, go from 0 to 20 degrees. That's pretty cold, and I'm gonna be wearing at least a short sleeve, a long sleeve shirt, a thicker jacket of some sort. The jacket that I have on now is a medium weight, kind of a fleece type jacket with a hoodie. I don't think that would be enough for me on a day that it was, you know, 10 degrees out. And I'd definitely be wearing thick gloves and probably a fleece lined pair of pants or a thinner hiking type pant with long underwear underneath. So I would be, that would be about as much as I would wear. And if I was going for an all day thing, I would definitely pack a puffy and maybe even a pair of like kind of rain cover pants or something like that. If I decided I was going to stop for a break, I would definitely not be wearing a ball cap. I'd be wearing a beanie and probably a medium weight beanie at that. But you know, those days for me are not super common just because we don't get that temperature range that often, except in the morning. And in the morning, it can easily be in the teens, you know, 15 degrees out. And you know, if that's the case, I'm just going to make sure I'm booking it pretty hard and keeping my body temperature up just through sheer exercise. And again, probably not planning to be out all day, maybe just for a half hour or an hour before work or something like that. In a normal range here in the Sierra Nevada of 20 to 30 degrees, I'll be wearing similar to what I'm wearing now. And honestly, if I wasn't stopping to film as often as I have been, I wouldn't be wearing this jacket. I mean, just a little bit that I've been doing with having a synthetic t-shirt underneath a lightweight merino wool long sleeve, and then this, I am sweating like crazy, but it is like 35 to 40 degrees out here too. So yeah, there's that. But if it was a normal 20 to 30 degree temperature day, I'd probably have a vest on instead of this. I'd still have the t-shirt, long sleeve shirt, but then a vest over the top. Or I might just plan on doing what I'm doing, taking a lot of breaks and just cooling myself off that way. A ball cap is usually fine for me. If I wasn't wearing a ball cap, I'd be wearing a lightweight beanie. And then I also prefer just a really light pair of gloves. So this one that I have on, it's actually a mountain biking brand of gloves. And I love them because, as you can see, I wear a watch. A lot of cross-country skiing oriented gloves will have some sort of additional sleeve or gauntlet type thing that will go up and over your wrist so they don't get cold. But that just irritates me a lot because, again, now it's covering up the watch. And most of the time, sleeves nowadays in outdoor clothing are so long anyway that you don't necessarily need that extra gauntlet. So I use a really thin pair of gloves for anything within 20 to 30 degrees outside. I do have a thick pair of gloves and a thick beanie packed in my hip belt or my lumbar pack, but I'm not using it today. It's super warm out here. And then that last range of anything above like 35 degrees, now we're talking spring conditions, and I'll be wearing maybe just a long sleeve shirt. And you know, when I talk about all these different clothings, just know that I generally prefer some type of a synthetic, a merino wool, something that's gonna wick sweat away and not just soak on top of me and hold it forever. So generally speaking, cotton is out. But believe it or not, there's a lot of manufacturers that have incorporated cotton into their clothing, and it's a blend of, you know, some sort of synthetic with cotton. Honestly, I don't have any problem with that, especially if I'm, you know, in some sort of environment where the fabric may actually be drying out a little bit just because the sun's out or there's a little bit of wind that can help dry things out. But generally speaking, I'll stick with some type of a synthetic or a merino wool. One thing I forgot to mention about the spring kind of conditions is wearing short sleeve shirts or shorts even, some people will do. And just know that it's all fun and games until you go down. You can still get road rash on firm condition snow. So I usually will just wear a long sleeve shirt as a minor protection layer if I go down. So that second criteria that I use to pick clothing out of is based on wind, and lo and behold, some just kicked up. If it's gonna be anywhere below, you know, 32 degrees freezing and there's gonna be wind, I'm definitely gonna be wearing an extra layer. I'll go ahead and put a t-shirt on, a long sleeve shirt, and then probably some type of, you know, wind resistant type of an outer layer, whether that's a full jacket or some type of a zip up hoodie like I'm wearing right now. But even this little hoodie that I got on, there's a high probability that the wind would just cut right through it and I would get cold pretty quick. But plan for that wind by packing extra layer to put on top of everything. So a lot of times some type of a windbreaker jacket, wind resistant jacket, that sort of thing is what I'll keep. If it's super cold, now Minnesota cold, you know, wind chill factor dropping the temperature by 20 to 30 degrees and you're already starting in a single digit, you're on your own with that. I don't usually end up skiing in those conditions. So you're gonna have to talk to somebody from Scandinavian countries about that. I think if you're that cold, you know what you need to wear. Just know that cross-country skiing, snowshoeing is a pretty highly aerobic activity, so you're gonna sweat. The problem with bundling up so much though is that you trap that sweat in there and then you stop for a moment and you start to freeze because of it. So wind chill is definitely a factor, and you know, I'll pick terrain based on that wind. If I know it's windy, I'm not going to the highest peak I can find. I'm probably gonna stay in the trees, for example. I'm getting a little ahead of myself at this point, but I just wanted to throw that out there. Still got that trick question lingering in the background there. Precipitation is definitely a factor. Is that going to be powdery and dry, fluffy snow, or is that going to be sopping wet flakes that soak every aspect of your being? You know, the dry, cold snow, that's fine. It just like sloughs off. You can just brush it off and not have much of a worry about it. It's just when it starts to get really moist and humid type snow, and then it starts sticking and instantly saturating all your clothing. That's a problem. Then there's always the case where you may be at an elevation where it's not actually snowing yet, it's still raining. So if you look at my first cross-country ski vlog from the beginning of the season, that was rainy conditions there, and I went ahead and wore an actual waterproof jacket. Now, I would seldom wear an actual waterproof jacket. Most of the jackets that I own are some form of a water resistant, durable water repellent. Anything lesser than proof is usually what I prefer in a wetter snow condition, and I'm not planning on being outside all day. If I was gonna be outside for long, long periods of time and I knew that snow was just gonna soak me to the bone, I would definitely wear a waterproof. But if I'm only going out for an hour or two, I'm not too worried because I know I can make it out and back in time before I start to get into a hypothermic condition or anything like that. And I'll also just ski a little bit faster if that's the case. So yeah, a lot of the types of jackets that I prefer to are usually less than proof when it comes to their water durability and permeability. I just like that, and it helps me shed sweat and perspiration a lot easier when I'm not wearing a full waterproof jacket. So I have all kinds of different jackets, and just look at the thumbnails or look at any of my videos and you see I got like a million jackets. I'm kind of a consumer when it comes to outdoor gear like that, right? But yeah, most of those jackets are not waterproof. They're usually just some sort of a water repellent or resistant. And don't ask me what the definition of repellent, resistant, proof, hydrophobic, they're all different. I don't know. I couldn't tell you. I just know that anything less than waterproof is gonna let water in to some degree, but it also is gonna let you get rid of your body sweat a lot faster than something that's fully waterproof. Fourth consideration or criteria is what type of terrain are you going to be skiing or traveling over? Or more specifically, what is the route that you're taking? Are you going straight uphill and then coming straight downhill? Are you going over a long, open, flat area? Are you going through rolling terrain with spotted forests here and there? All that stuff I take into consideration. As you might imagine, if I'm going straight uphill, I'll probably dress a little bit light and then maybe have a jacket or some sort of a fleece pullover to put on for the downhill portion if the temperatures are chilly. If I'm going to be going across a meadow and the wind is high and I'm going to be cold and unprotected, I may dress a little bit warmer for that. So I'll have t-shirt, long sleeve, fleece, and who knows, maybe I'll even put on a really light jacket. But chances are, I mean, realistically, I usually just wear at the most three layers on top. T-shirt, long sleeve, and vest. T-shirt, long sleeve, and light jacket or polar fleece of sorts. It's not super scientific for me just because I tend to run pretty hot when I'm skiing. I know myself when it comes to getting cold and when I'm getting cold, and I know when I need to pick up the pace so that I can moderate that temperature. Route selection definitely plays a role in how I'm going to be dressed, but it's usually just a slight modification. And a lot of times, if I sweat a lot going uphill, I'm hoping that I cool down on the way back or dry out a little bit on the way downhill. Another subsection of terrain would be snow conditions, or the conditions such that you're going to be slogging through a foot and a half of deep fluffy powder, or are they more spring-like where all the snow is set and you got a firm base and you can kind of zip along. In both conditions, you may find yourself sweating a lot anyway, whether you're working through that deep stuff or zipping along through the firm stuff. So the last main consideration I take into account, or criteria that I use to determine what type of clothing I'm going to be wearing, is the purpose of my little winter adventure. Now, I realize a lot of people are like, what are you talking about purpose? What are you talking about goals and intentions for your adventure? What does that mean? Well, are you planning on just doing a 30-minute heart-pounding workout? Or are you planning on doing a all-day ski tour from point to point with car shuttles? Whether you like it or not, those are all goals. Those are all purposes. Those are all intentions. And it's important to clarify yours before you go. I don't want to get too much on the whole planning aspect of going outside, but this is a critical element. Having a clear idea of what you want to see accomplished for that mission or that adventure. If you don't have clear intentions for your experience, it kind of undermines the whole experience, in my opinion. And again, it doesn't have to be a super complex goal. It can just be, I want to go ski for 3 miles and then go home and have lunch. It can be that simple, but at least it's intentional. When you set the intention for that experience, it gives you something to work toward. And if you've ever been in a situation where there's a lot of uncertainty and now you have stressors placed on top of other stressors, stuff tends to come undone. And if you go out in the winter without any kind of clear plan for what you want to see accomplished on your little adventure, you may find yourself in a really challenging position because you don't have a goal in which you're working toward. It's hard to stay focused on being anything other than cold. For me, that is a contributing factor to staying warm, is knowing why I'm out here. So that, okay, yeah, I'm getting cold now. I've been talking long enough. I better ski for a little while and then I'll talk again. I can stave off that coldness or that concern that, man, am I gonna make it back to my Jeep, you know, without shivering and shaking and being hypothermic or whatever. So just knowing why you're doing it, even if it's just for a time period. I'm gonna go walk in the woods for 1 hour. Well, that means you got 30 minutes to get out and then 30 minutes to get back. And in that 30 minutes, you can break that down into sections, right? Every 5-10 minute increments. How much longer can I be out here for before I start getting really cold? Or do I need to stop and let my body cool down a little bit before I move on, because I'm overheating and I don't want to get all wet and sweaty and then for some reason have to stop for too long and get really frozen. So anyway, that's a huge factor. And again, that's why I wore this top layer, this thicker over layer, compared to my normal probably t-shirt and long sleeve shirt and maybe a vest on a day where it was 35 degrees and overcast and kind of humid out. I knew that I'd be stopping, so I wore this extra layer. And I actually wore a pair of pants that had some fleece lining in it rather than my usual hiking type pant that doesn't have any kind of liner. I just knew that I'd be standing around for longer periods of time. So we have five criteria that we can gauge our clothing selection on, right? We have that temperature, wind, precipitation, terrain, and then what our goal for our little winter adventure is. And I hinted at this being a trick question, but of those five criteria, which one do you believe you can and cannot control? If you said, well, I can't control the temperature, I can't control the wind, and I can't control the amount of rain or snow falling out of the sky, you'd be right. And if you said, I can control where I go and I can control what my intention is for the mission, you'd also be right. But you'd also be slightly wrong on those first three. It's true, we can't actually change the temperature outside, right? But we can choose a different time of day in which to go out and ski. Instead of skiing at 15 degrees in the morning, maybe I'll wait until noon and go ski at like 30 degrees. Instead of skiing to the top of a peak when it's cold out and it's probably gonna be colder up top, maybe I'll ski in a lower elevation. Perhaps instead of taking a little tour down into a valley where cold air may be collecting and gathering, I may go mid-mountain and be somewhere where it's a little bit warmer. You can, to some degree, control the temperature of your experience. You can't control the actual temperature, obviously, but you can make choices that will result in you being outside at better for you times of the day or locations. And that kind of goes all back to terrain feature, route selection, intention for your winter adventure. If it is windy and you know you're going to be going out, maybe you choose terrain that's more favorable to protect you from wind, such as an area protected by trees, instead of going to the top of a fully exposed peak or out over across an open meadow where wind is just going to sweep from one end to the other in a short amount of time. True, you can't control the wind, but you can control where you go so that you can be somewhat buffered from the wind. Maybe the winds are going to die down later. Maybe they die down earlier, or they're going to pick up later. So choosing a better time of your day to go out on that adventure. And the same goes for precipitation, right? Choosing a time before or after it starts to snow, or choosing a different elevation at which you ski. At my house, which I'm at about 6,300 feet, is what's considered lake level for Lake Tahoe. Basically the elevation of Lake Tahoe, right? I'm only maybe 100 feet up, 200 feet at the most, but a lot of snow will not actually collect at lake level. It'll collect at the higher elevations above 7,000 feet, but it's oftentimes just rain or sleet down at lake level. So I may decide to forego the rainy sleet kind of a condition and go higher up in elevation. Can't control the weather, but you can definitely pick more favorable times for you to be out and more favorable locations in which you can go. Trick question, but just food for thought, that clothing selection is all based on all these factors. And I'm no meteorologist or snow expert or anything like that, but because I have been living in snowy climates, you know, I know what 0 degrees Fahrenheit feels like when the snot in your nostrils freezes. And I might wait later in the day or forego completely an adventure if it's that cold out. I know how I ski at 25 degrees outside and a little bit of wind. I can do it in light amount of clothing. You have to figure out what works for you. And over time, as you go outside more, you become more acclimated to the temperature and you become a little bit more insulated. Not because you have more layers of fat or anything like that. It's just you're conditioning your mind, you're conditioning your body and metabolism to respond a certain way. So there's some seasons where I'll be out skiing, you know, 100 to 130 days. I'll find that every time I come in after I go out or every time I go to bed, I'll have to open my window because I am just so warm from being used to being outside for so long. That's kind of a cool thing because now you are adapting to your environment. You're becoming a little bit more in tune with what's going on around you and outside. You also want to take into consideration your technique. So if you are cross-country skiing and perhaps your technique is not that good, you're probably going to be using a lot more energy and getting hotter because you're not as efficient. So that will cause you to get a little bit warmer. Same goes for you get better at technique and now you go faster and you go further, so you still burn a lot of energy, but it is more efficient at least. It's just that you're gonna be warm again. There's not really too many ways around getting hot when you're cross-country skiing. You are gonna get hot. A couple of other items just about regulating body temperature and being warm. So that's essentially what we're talking about when wearing the right clothes, right? We wanna be able to regulate our body temperature properly. I make sure that if I am going to be out, I'm going to eat something because that's going to bring a lot of increased body temperature in my core. Now, you don't want to wait until you're like freezing, right? You don't want to become to the point where you get hypothermic and try to eat something and hope that warms you up. That's not going to be a quick fix in any means. If you plan ahead, and again, setting intention, how long are we going to be out? Do I need to eat right before I go because I'm only going to be out 2 hours and I don't really want to stop? Or are we going to be out for 5 hours and I'm going to bring a big lunch or some hot soup or some hot chocolate or coffee or tea or whatever, right? Those are all contributing factors to remaining warm. You know, just that idea of having the comfort of eating. Unless, of course, you have gale force winds and it's a blizzard. Nobody wants to stop and do anything. They want to keep going, and I recommend that. Funny thing that I learned about taking the wilderness first responder course a year or two ago was that this concept of diuresis. I always wondered, why do I gotta pee so often when I go out in winter? I know I drink a lot of water before I go ski just so I don't have to drink a lot while I'm out there. But at the same time, when I get cold, I have to pee a lot. And this is the body's natural response. There's a lot of fluid that it's just trying to get rid of so that it doesn't have to waste energy trying to heat that up. It's not bad or good, it just is, and you have to be aware of that. So if you do find yourself peeing like 5 times in the first 2 miles, make sure you're drinking water, replenishing that. As your body naturally gets warmer from exercising, it's gonna need that extra fluid so that you don't get dehydrated. Lots of talking today. Lots of information. And I haven't even talked about brands. Most of the time, what I buy is gear that you could get from REI, from outdoor retailers, you know, good quality ones. And I like to support those good quality brands. For example, I got darn tough socks on. I got Montbel ski pants that are fleece lined. I have an REI synthetic shirt. I have a Fjällräven lightweight merino wool long sleeve, a Fjällräven, this zip up hoodie. I have these hand up gloves. I got a cool brand ball cap. I got a pretty expensive outfit on and it works for me though. It's functional, it looks good. It's functional. That's the most important thing, right? It moves the way I move when I'm skiing. I'm not worried about some weird pleating going on or some thing that feels restrictive that I'm going to tear my sleeve every time I go to pull or anything like that. Everything I wear is functionally oriented. Anyway, more long-winded stuff from me. Hope you don't mind. most of what I try to talk about has some sort of broader concept in it. I don't care what brands you buy. Again, I don't get sponsored. Nobody is giving me gear to pump for them or push or hype. I'm just not into that, so don't ask me to do that for you. The only thing that I'm really interested in selling is more of a lifestyle of being outside and doing healthy activities. What I want is I want you guys to go outside, have a good time, become good stewards of the land, value and appreciate open space and wild land, and in turn, hopefully support, fund, promote the initiatives, organizations, and projects that do conserve and preserve outdoor land. And why do I want that? Because I want more land to go out and play in. If you like the video, give it a thumbs up. If you have any feedback or questions, post it in the comment section below. Subscribe to my YouTube channel and then check out TahoeTrailGuide.com. I also want to start plugging. I do run a Patreon account now. If you feel compelled to give me any kind of monetary contribution and want to do that on a monthly basis, I have pretty low commitment options, $3, $6, $9. I also have a paypal.me option. It's just a way that you can just put a single one-time monetary tip contribution. Anyway, GoPro stop capture.